Now we are live.
Okay. May I start?
Yeah.
Okay. Very warm greetings to all. Today we have virtually gathered here to attend an international webinar entitled Effects of Agnihotra on Our Environment, Agriculture and Human Health. Before moving to the final session, I would like to introduce our key speaker, Dr. Ulrich Berg. Dr. Ulrich Berg belongs to Germany, a renowned scientist working on different aspects of homeotherapy. He has completed his PhD in 1976 from University Erlangen, Nuremberg. Post to his education, he worked as professor in Konstanz University, teaching logic and methodology of sciences to students of different faculties. Since 1980, he has been coordinating research on homeotherapy based on Agnihotra. Initially, he mainly focused on Eastern European countries, but gradually his work spread throughout the world. He also invested a few years in India and worked in coordination with different universities. He has several publications in his pocket. Further, proceeding further, I would request our HOD, Dr. Shekhar Jain, for delivering a welcome note for our key speaker and for the participants, and also to enlighten Faculty of Life Science, Mansoor University. So please.
Thanks, Dr. Rathore. So first of all, welcome to all the participants and Dr. Ulrich. On behalf of Faculty of Life Sciences, I would like to brief about the Faculty of Life Sciences. We are a part of Mansoor University, one of the emerging university situated in the heart of India, in the Madhya Pradesh. And we are in a very developing conditions. We have around 16 faculties, different types of departments are there, out of which we are one of the department, Faculty of Life Sciences, which is dealing with the biotechnology and microbiology. And in both the streams, we are running graduate as well as postgraduate courses. What about the things about the today's webinar that it is somehow unique for the life science audience? We are going to learn today one of the unique topic, that how Agnihotra is going to positive effect on our environment, agriculture and our social activities. So for that things, first of all, I would like to thanks Dr. Ulrich to accept our invitation to enlighten us about this very much interesting topic. And definitely, I hope it will be a very good and very unique thing for all the participants. So without any interruption, now I request to Dr. Ulrich, please enlighten our participants about the Agnihotra. Please, Dr. Ulrich.
Okay, first I want to thank you, Dr. Shekhar Jain, Head of Department Life Science of Mansoor University, and also to thank Dr. Tanya Sengupta Rathore, whom I met long time back in Damnot, and we even have one publication together. And so I thank you both for inviting me for this webinar. And now I want to start. Okay, you see the screen now?
No. Yes.
Okay. So my subject is effects of Agnihotra on our environment, agriculture, and on human health. Now, why this subject? Last month we had World Environment Day. And that's a new development to have a World Environment Day, because now more and more people realize that we are dependent on nature. Nature is not dependent on us. Nature could well do without humans. And we have mistreated nature too long, too much for too long. And now consequences are getting more and more visible. I just give two examples. One example is health. Look at this graphics. You see on the map the relation of pollution-related deaths in the different countries. And you see India is in the highest category, say 20 to 27% of deaths are related to environmental pollution, pollution of atmosphere, of soil, of water resources, and of food. So that shows it's a big problem. Then also, it's not only humans who suffer from this environmental pollution, plants also suffer. And the effects are that leaves are getting damaged, and that makes plants more vulnerable to pests and diseases. Photosynthesis is reduced, growth of plants is reduced, and the yield goes down by 5 to 20% according to recent studies. So we have to go for home organic farm, for organic farming. But there's an apprehension engine that when we move from conventional agriculture to organic farming, there will be a drop in yield. And some studies also confirm that. But if we go to home organic farming, then there will be no drop in yield, even yields are higher than with conventional farming. I just show you the result of one study done at Darwad Agricultural University, Darwad in Karnataka, and they show, they examined four crops, soybeans, cabbage, tomatoes, and okra. It was four MSC theses, and the result was in all the parameters, health and pest and so on, this Homa organic plot was best, and the yield went up by 15%, 26%, 43%, 28%. So with Homa organic farming methods, you avoid all these polluting chemicals, and still you get more yield than compared with conventional farming. So now, what is this method, Homa organic farming, which increases yield, reduces pests and diseases, and even improves health of the farmers as a side effect? How does it work, and why is it so beneficial for growth of plants? The basic tool of Homa organic farming is Agnihotra. That is a simple fire done in a copper pyramid according to biorhythm of sunrise and sunset. It comes from Vedic knowledge. And what you need is a copper pyramid of fixed size and shape. And the ingredients which you burn are first dried cow dung, pure cow dung, not mixed with buffalo or anything else. Pure cow's ghee, again pure, only from cow's milk. Some grains of unbroken pieces of unpolished rice. Then you need some simple mantras, an exact vibration, and the timetable of sunrise and sunset, exact to the second. Why these mantras? Why the exact time? There's description given in this ancient knowledge saying that at sunrise, the many fires, electricities, ethers, and more subtle energies come all the way from the sun to the earth. And this flood of energies has a subtle music in it. And the quintessential sound of that music is a mantra which we utter at that time. Therefore, we have some kind of resonance effect. And this explains why first the mantra has to be exact, the Sanskrit mantra, because then otherwise the resonance effect would not work. And second, why do we have to be so peculiar about the exact timing? Because this flood of energies culminates only for a very short time band, and we have to catch that short time band. Interesting enough, some American astrophysicists showed this slide in a presentation, and he said a very similar thing. He said at sunrise, million ampere currents head towards the Earth at sunrise, and they go out, are sent out again at sunset. So it is confirmation of this traditional ancient Vedic knowledge through modern astrophysics. The procedure is very simple. You prepare the fire in this copper pyramid a couple of minutes before the time of sunrise, sunset. And then you take a few grains of this unbroken rice in your left hand, make two portions, add some drops of ghee so that each rind trace is covered by ghee, and then divide into two portions. And after when you utter the mantras, after the word Swaha, each time you add one portion of this rice covered with ghee to the fire. So in the morning it is Suryaya Swaha, Suryaya Idam Namama, Prajapataye Swaha, Prajapataye Idam Namama. And in the evening, Agnaye Swaha, Agnaye Idam Namama, Prajapataye Swaha, Prajapataye Idam Namama. What happens is, it is said that the channel is created through all the atmosphere, and prana energy, life energy, which sits above the atmosphere, comes down through this channel, and an aura energy field is created around all plants nearby. So these plants get stronger, get disease resistant. And when the flame dies, this energy comes back and it's collected in the Agnihotra ash. Therefore, the Agnihotra ash has healing properties, can be used for plants, can be used for healing wounds, can be used for medicine for animals and for humans. Now, how does Agnihotra work? First thing is, Agnihotra purifies our environment, the atmosphere, water resources, and soil. And thus, Agnihotra brings all nature back to harmony. First, let us look at effects of Agnihotra on the atmosphere. One thing is, according to Vedic knowledge, and by the way, also according to biodynamic farming, it is said that plants get most of their nutrition through the atmosphere. Nowadays, agricultural science mainly concentrates on soil, so they add nutrients to the soil, but they do not take into account that a lot of nutrition comes from the atmosphere. Now, what happens if the atmosphere is polluted? You know, plants' capacity to breathe is reduced. So all the different problems come, diseases, pests, and also reduction in yield. Now, what happens if we perform Agnihotra? When we perform Agnihotra, our atmosphere is purified. You can easily see if you open a petri dish before Agnihotra, say open for 10 minutes, then close. So you take the bacteria, microbial load of the air, and then you cultivate the bacteria, and then you do the same thing after Agnihotra, also open for 10 minutes and then close and send for cultivation, and you see the difference. There's a lot of reduction in bacterial growth before Agnihotra and after Agnihotra. Here you see the graphics, there's approximately 70% less. These studies were done in different places and also published. Now, what about, that was biological air pollution. What about chemical air pollution and physical air pollution? Chemical air pollution is mainly SOx and NOx, and physical air pollution is mainly particulate matter. And we have seen in several experiments, one was done at North Maharashtra University in Chalgaon, that we perform Agnihotra and the count of chemical and physical air pollution right after Agnihotra goes up a little bit because there's some smoke produced by Agnihotra. But then it comes down by 30 to 40%, by just one Agnihotra. And then there was one doubt. People said, okay, because we performed this experiment in the evening, at sunset Agnihotra, they said, or maybe during the night, automatically, you know, the particles will settle down and so on. So we did the same thing from morning to evening, and we got the same result. So Agnihotra purifies the air, both biological, second chemical, third physical air pollution. One important indicator of fresh air is the count of negative ions. Lack of negative ions indicates polluted air, and normally smoke reduces the amount of negative ions. So one experiment done more than 30 years ago in Germany was quite interesting. I went to an engineer who had such an equipment to measure the concentration of negative ions in the air. So I went to him and I talked a little bit about Agnihotra, and then he asked, oh, will there be some smoke produced by this Agnihotra fire? And I said, yeah, there will be some smoke. Because of fire, and you know, normally if you have a fire, it's normal that there's some smoke. And he said, oh, if there's smoke, we don't have to do this experiment, because if there's smoke, definitely negative ions will go down. And in order to prove his statement, he took a cigarette, blew the smoke in the direction of the instrument, and yes, negative ions went down. I said, okay, let's try. And so I performed Agnihotra, and what happened immediately after Agnihotra, negative ion count went up. So that's quite interesting, because it shows that there must be a difference between normal smoke and Agnihotra smoke. And that would be interesting to examine more what that difference is. Now, what are the effects of Agnihotra and Agnihotra ash on water resources? There was one experiment done in one college in Pune. They took polluted water from a river, and they poured that water through a cylinder, glass cylinder, which was filled with Agnihotra ash. So the polluted water was poured into the cylinder filled with Agnihotra ash, and what came down was measured. And here you see the details, all the parameters. The water was much, much, much better. Actually, it was fulfilling the standards of World Health Organization for drinking water. Here you see the reduction in conductivity, total solid content, hardness, BOD, COD, and especially the bacteria. A lot of reduction in this bacteria. So from very polluted water, you got drinking water quality by just pouring it through a column of Agnihotra ash. Another experiment was done near Mumbai on the effect of Agnihotra ash on water which was polluted by a textile industry. You know, the effluent of this textile industry went to a river, and even if it's diluted a lot, means only 15% of this effluent, 85% of fresh water from the river, still biotic life was not possible. But if you added just half a gram per liter of water to this mixture, then biotic life again was possible. Here you also see the COD reduced by more than half if you added half a gram of Agnihotra ash to 1 liter of this mixture. 15% effluent, the rest fresh water of the river. The effect of Agnihotra on a borewell. This was done on a farm in Australia, a farm which was in a very dry area, comparable to Rajasthan in India. And so they drilled the borewell, and they were successful, means they got water. But the water was highly saline and alkaline. pH was 9.5 and salinity 1150 parts per million. So this water was not could not be used for neither animals nor plants, forget about drinking. So what these people did is they just performed Agnihotra next to the bore well and added Agnihotra ash regularly once a week. And after 6 months, pH had come down from 9.5 to 7.2, and salinity from 1150 came down to 720, which, and that is within the range which World Health Organization gives for drinking water. So basically, that saved their farm. Now, what is are the effects of Agnihotra on the soil? First, let us remember one thing, and that is a text, Sanskrit text written around 1500 before Christ, and that said, upon this handful of soil, our survival depends. Husband it, and it will grow our food, our fuel, and our shelter, and surround us with beauty. Abuse it, and the soil will collapse and die, taking humanity with it. The and that is quite threatening, because according to data from the FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, it is said that already now 1/3 of the world's soil has been degraded as compared to 1960. And they say, unless new approaches are adopted, the global amount of arable and productive land per person in 2050 will be only a quarter of the level in 1960. And that will definitely not be enough to feed this growing number of people. So we have to care of soil health. The soil has to be rejuvenated, and first it has to be rejuvenated by homotherapy methods. If this soil is rejuvenated by these homotherapy methods, then different types of microorganisms, starting from the level of viruses, bacteria, fungi, algae, thrive. And thus a healthy microflora and microfauna is created. And that has been confirmed. First observation was when they examined soil, the phosphate level of soil in US more than 30 years ago. You know that, of course, all plants need phosphorus, and normally there's not enough phosphate in the soil, but mostly it is of non-soluble form, not water soluble, and therefore the plants can't make use of it. So what this scientist found out, if they add Agnihotra ash to the soil, the percentage of water-soluble phosphate increases, and increases quite a bit, 2, 3, 4 times. Then the question was, how come? What is the underlying mechanism? And one hypothesis was, oh no, that is another experiment which was confirming the same thing. Water solubility of phosphorus is increased if you add Agnihotra ash. Then the question, how come? And there was a hypothesis that phosphorus solubilizing bacteria are responsible for the increase in plant available phosphorus. And now recently, this hypothesis has been confirmed by a study done in Ratnagiri College. And they found out if you add Agnihotra ash to the soil, the nitrogen fixing bacteria are increasing 100 times. And the phosphorus solubilizing bacteria even 1,000 times. Interesting enough, at the same time, fungal flora is controlled. Some other studies, these were done in an ICAR institute in Lucknow, Institute of Subtropical Horticulture, and they found out that pathogenic fungi are controlled with Agnihotra ash. Here you see control, there's a lot of growth, Agnihotra ash, no growth, and control ash, some growth. control ash, I want to explain, is the ash which we get when we burn the same substances, cow dung, ghee, cow's ghee, some rice. We even burn it in a copper vessel because copper can have some catalytic properties in the combustion process. But the copper vessel is not of this size and shape, not the pyramid shape. And we do not use the mantras, and we don't do it at the time of sunrise and sunset. But otherwise, it's the same. We burn the same substances, same amount of the substances, and still the effect is different, as you can see here. Now, these were the pathogenic fungi. They are controlled by Agnihotra. But the beneficial microbes with Agnihotra ash, they are increased. So that shows that Agnihotra brings nature back to harmony. You know, things which are which work negatively, they are controlled. Things which help nature, they are increased. Another example, sodic soil. There are large areas in India, especially in UP, with sodic soil, sodic saline soil. So there was one plot in a KVK where the pH was 9.86. The experiment was, they made three plots. One was with agrochemicals, the normal procedure. One with organic farming using vermicompost. And the third, organic farming, vermicompost with Agnihotra ash. And see how the soil pH changed. With agrochemicals, there was no change. It stayed at 9.86. With organic and vermicompost, it came down a little bit to 9.06. But with vermicompost and Agnihotra ash, pH came down more than 2 points, down to 7.67. Also, in the field with Agnihotra ash, potash and phosphorus were more abundant. Now, you see, Agnihotra and Agnihotra ash help in the case of sodic soil. What about acidic soil? There's one farm in Poland, and the pH was 4.4, very acidic. And government agriculture engineer who came said, see, forget about it, nothing will grow there. But still people tried, used Agnihotra, of course, performed Agnihotra, used Agnihotra ash, and you see, they grew everything. And after some time, they got the soil measured again, and the pH was up to 7.2, quite neutral. So you see, Agnihotra works in both cases. Sodic soil brings pH down. Acidic soil, it brings it up. And if we just look at India agriculture, there are approximately 9 million hectares of sodic and saline soil alone, 2.5 million alone in the Ganga Plains. And there are more than 6 million hectares of strongly acidic soil, means pH is less than 4.5, especially in Arunachal Pradesh. So if these lands could be reclaimed and made productive again by Homa farming methods, that would help a lot to increase agriculture production and feed a growing number of people. So why not start a small project on either acidic or sodic soil or on both? That's not a big investment. The experiment is pretty simple, and the possible gain is huge considering all the large areas which could be made productive, you know, both sodic and saline soil, sodic and acidic soil. It is more than 13 million hectares, a large area. Now, what are the effects of Agnihotra on plants? There are many different experiments and reports, and we have seen that diseases in various crops in various climatic zones on different continents have been controlled like woolly aphid in sugarcane, mango hopper and mealybug in mangoes, bollworm in cotton. Also, it has been shown that Acne hotter increases yields in crops like soybeans, mangoes, bananas, different vegetables, and so on. Experiments have been done at the universities of Palampur, Coimbatore, Uti, Dharwad, Esviasa in Bangalore, and so on. The documentation is available in the proceedings of a conference edited by Berg and Johnson 2009. And more such reports you can see on the webpage www.homafarming.com. Simple experiments which can be done even on school level are with germination of seeds. Here, that's very simple. You take a petri dish with a little bit of some tissue and some add some seeds, and then you add tap water. You add right side Acne hotter ash with tap water. But then we were in science, we have to be fair. And any we know that any ash has some nutrients. So it's not fair to just compare tap water with Acne hotter ash because you know, you could use any ash and it would help and be better than tap water. So what we always do is we have a second control, that is with control ash. As I explained, control ash, you burn the same substances, cow dung, cow's ghee, some rice, also in a copper vessel, but not the typical shape of this Acne hotter pyramid, and no mantra, and at the time of sunrise and sunset. And you see very clearly, yes, control ash is better than just using tap water. If you would just burn wood, also that would be better, but there's a clear difference. Acne hotter ash is much better. So that is a very simple experiment, can easily be done by anybody to get some first results on this. So that was using Acne hotter ash. Now another experiment was done with performing Acne hotter and see the effect on plant growth. And you compared shoot length and root length. And you see with Acne hotter ash, there's a big increase in both shoot length and root length with Acne hotter, performing Acne hotter. Now, one more important thing is the nutrient content of plants. Now, often plants which we can buy on the market, they look good. They are also maybe have a nice size. But what about the nutrient content? And many people say plants like fruits like or crops like tomatoes, they don't taste like they used to taste when we were young. And so that indicates something is missing. And so other studies have shown a decline in nutrient content of plants, which by the way, may lead to several health problems. And also Ayurvedic doctors have told that the medical potency of plants they use is declining because of pollution. How can Acne hotter help? This is one result, a farmer who grew vanilla in the Balgaum area, Karnataka, he got the vanillin content tested and the result was 36% by weight. And the test lab, they didn't believe that could be possible because normally they get 25%, maximum 28%, but never 36. So they run the test again and it was confirmed. The vanillin content was 36%. So that shows the quality increases with HOMA farming. Another study was done in Warsaw University. They compared HOMA organic farming with organic farming and conventional farming and see in all the parameters, dry matters, sugars total, sugars reducing, and organic acids, Acne hotter was the best. Acne hotter farm products were the best. Another important aspect is biodiversity, because we are losing biodiversity at an alarming pace. Just one example. Last year, a study was published in Germany, and the result was that within 25 years, there was a reduction in insect population of 75%. 70% less, 5% less insect in just 25 years. And one of the scientists involved in the study, he says that is like ecological Armageddon, ecological catastrophe. And that's just one aspect of the loss of biodiversity, just concerning insects. There are many other things also. So how can Aknahotta help? There were two studies, and one was in about invertebrates and one about butterflies. By the way, these studies were done under the guidance of Dr. Shailendra Sharma, principal of Dumnot College. And here you see the added values of invertebrates in a riverbed in the Narmada River. And you see there were two research stations upstream and two research stations downstream. And in the middle is the research station where Aknahotta is being performed and some other fires also. And you see a big, big difference. There's a big increase in the count of invertebrates at this station, which is close to the Ohoma farming place. And a similar result you get with butterflies. There's a lot of more butterflies in this Homa therapy place compared to the other stations which we also examined. And here you see a photo with all the different butterflies in this Homa therapy place. Now, if we talk about Homa farming, there's the question always, how much land can you cover with this Homa farming method? And there's one technique called resonance technique, where you, with a set of 10 pyramids, which are activated once and then put in different places like north, south, east, west, you can cover an area of up to 200 acres. And still, you only have to do one Aknahotta in the middle of the farm, and then some additional fire in some other place, which people can share to do that. And as most farms in India are not so big, so it is possible that more farmers come and join hands, work together, and you have here a multi. Here, like 24 different farms, they all work together. They have in the middle one Aknahotta up, and all their lands are covered by this resonance technique. So it's a very economical, also time-consuming way, and a lot of area can be covered. So this Homa organic farming leads to sustainable future. We can achieve rural development on village level, as I just showed, you know, whole village can work together and thus guarantee global food security. In addition to that, also human health is improved. The health of farmers is improved. There was one example, a farmer, mango farmer in Unnao area, Unnao between Lucknow and Kanpur. He performed Aknahotta and some other type of fire just for his farm. And he had very high blood pressure. The blood pressure level was 200. And then he, no, 300. And then he just performed Aknahotta for the farm. But then when he went to the doctor, you know, after 1 month or so, blood pressure, had, blood sugar level had come down to 200. And later on, even to 100. And the doctor said, no, that's not possible. It will go up again, but it did not, so he could stop all his medicine. One big example is Bhopal. Bhopal 1984, you know, this big catastrophe when the Union Carbide factory in Bhopal exploded and MIC gas leaked. Very poisonous gas. Thousands of people died and many, many more thousands were seriously injured. But all those who were performing Agnihotra daily in their houses, they were safe. Agnihotra proved to be a very protective armor for all of them. And that was big news at that time in national newspapers. Now, a very actual thing is the COVID-19 threat. Can Agnihotra help also with that? Yes, it can help. It can help in three different ways. First, it can reduce the probability of getting infected. Second, it reduces pre-existing conditions, which normally lead to a very severe cause of COVID-19, and that will be reduced. And also Agnihotra supports the body's immune system, which makes it easier for the body to overcome the infection. So pre-existing conditions are, for example, heart disease, high blood pressure, asthma, chronic bronchitis, diabetes, cancer, immune system deficiency. And all these conditions can be improved by Agnihotra. Just one example. Agnihotra regulates the blood pressure. That was a simple test. 10 people, blood pressure was measured before Agnihotra and after Agnihotra. And you see, those with high blood pressure, the blood pressure came down. But those at the bottom of the page with low blood pressure came up. So Agnihotra regulates the blood pressure. And that is one of the pre-existing conditions of COVID-19, which can be reduced by performing Agnihotra. In general, reports show that stress is relieved, blood pressure is regulated, blood sugar levels are controlled by just performing Agnihotra. And there are thousands of reports of different diseases healed by Agnihotra, like cancer, drug addiction, depression, and even HIV. HIV, there was one project done in Mysore, Karnataka, with young children. They all were, you know, one organization found them on the street, though they were given a home, shelter, good organic vegetarian food. And then they started to perform Agnihotra, the children themselves. Each child had his or her own pyramid and they performed Agnihotra themselves. And within 1 year, the viral load came down considerably, and also the general health of children improved. The immune system was much stronger. Before, they often had to call for the doctor in the middle of the night for some cold, for some infection, for whatever. And then this doctor told me that doesn't happen anymore after they started with Agnihotra. So it has a very strong effect, even in cases of HIV. If you want more information, you know, this is my contact information. For the email address is dght@homatherapie.de. So be careful, it's not Y like the English spelling, but IE like the German spelling, and DE stands for Germany. The webpage is same thing, homatherapie.de. And for health, you have www.homahealth.com. Then you have homatherapyindia.com and homatherapy.org. Okay, that's it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, sir, for your informative lectures. This has brushed up our thoughts for this type of traditional methods, which can be easily used and can be easily included in our life. Okay. Further, we will move to the question and answer session. Please, participants are requested to post their questions in the chat box so that I can further proceed for the question and answer session. And about the feedback link, it will be posted in the chat box only and it will be open for half an hour during query session only. Okay. Okay. Some questions were. Okay, this is the first question from Indrani Rajendra. Is there any heavy metal reduction in soil by using Agnihotra?
A reduction of what in soil?
Heavy metal concentration.
Heavy metals. Actually, this has not been tested yet. We were contacting some institute to see about arsenic contamination in soil and water. Until now, the experiments have not been done yet. So whoever is interested to do such experiment, I will be very happy to help with that, you know, supply the Agnihotra ash and so on.
Okay, there is one more question from Rupa. Is there any selection of material to be used in Agnihotra for different kinds of treatments?
No, Agnihotra is the same all the time. You just need this dried cow dung, pure cow dung. Make sure it's really pure from cows only, not buffaloes. That's a problem in India. And there were experiments showing that if you use the dung from buffaloes, you will not get the effect. So it has to be pure cow dung. Same with pure cow's ghee. There was one interesting report from a farmer, Oma farmer in Karnataka. He was growing sugarcane and always with very good results with his Oma techniques. But one year he got some pests. And then he was very much concerned what's happening. And then he checked it and found out that the ghee his manager of the farm had bought from the market, and the ghee was not pure cow's ghee, but it was contaminated with buffalo ghee. That led to this infection of the pest. And so immediately he made sure he gets pure ghee and then also got his own cow so that it would not happen again. And then interestingly enough, you know, predators came and took care of the pest. He didn't have to do anything, just you know, make sure that the method is done correctly. And for using Agnihotra and Agnihotra ash for medicine, the thing is, it is you have to be very, of course, more careful about all things to be done exactly. And then you can mix the Agnihotra ash. You can apply the ash as it is on your skin, if you have some skin problem. You can mix the ash also with ghee, also for external application. You can mix the ash with water. You can drink the water with ash. You can take the ash internally as it is also. And also you can mix the ash with honey for internal application. So there are different applications, but Agnihotra itself is always the same.
Okay, sir. There is one interesting question from Lokesh Sharma. Whether Agnihotra ash will kill microbes, especially viruses, including coronavirus?
I do not think that Agnihotra ash will kill microbes. Because that is an ahimsa method, so nothing is killed. But what we've seen, that Agnihotra ash reduces the multiplication of microbes and even it reduces the multiplication of multi-drug resistant bacteria. So there was one experiment done in Kathmandu University, Kathmandu U in Nepal, and that showed within 3 days the count of strain of E. coli bacteria came down from 2,400 to less than 3, just within 3 days. So Agnihotra reduces these microbes. Now about viruses, there was one experiment done with one kind of coronavirus, not the present coronavirus responsible for COVID-19, but some previous coronavirus. And with viruses, as you know, you're from life science, you know better than I, you cannot cultivate viruses like you can do with most of the bacteria. So you have to insert these viruses in some cells, and in a cell line you can do the experiment. The problem is, in the cell line experiment, you cannot add acne hot or ash. Whatever you add, it has to be filtered. So what we did is, we added acne hot or ash to water, let that sit for 24 hours, and then sieved it. And then that water could be added to the cell line. And we saw a reduction in the viruses of 50%. Now, people might say, and it's not so much, but still, that can be make the difference between some very severe cause of the disease and a mild disease, or even between not getting a mild cause of the disease and not getting it at all. There's one more aspect. We have seen with bacteria that acne hot or ash reduces the cell formation of bacteria. And so if the same thing happens with viruses, you could assume that also acne hot or ash could damage the outer layer of the coronavirus, and thus make it no longer viral. So that's one aspect. How does acne hot or ash work on the virus itself? Another aspect is maybe even more important. Acne hot or purifies the atmosphere. Normally, bacteria and also these viruses, they travel on particles, on aerosols. So if the atmosphere is purified from these particles and particulate matter and from these aerosols, you know, automatically these viruses are also removed. And that would be a very interesting experiment to do with viruses. With bacteria, we have done it very often, but with viruses had not been done yet. And that would be very interesting, especially in our time, means go to a hospital where they have COVID-19 patients, measure the count of these viruses in the air in a room with these COVID-19 patients, then perform acne hot or ash, and then say half an hour later, measure the level again. That will be a very interesting experiment. You know, for those who are interested in this COVID-19 and acne hot or ash, I've written a paper and also it's published in the meantime. So just send me an email and I can send you that paper.
Okay, so thank you. There is one more interesting question from Arif Khan. He's asking about mosquito transmission diseases. Is the Agnihotra is effective in mosquito transmitted diseases?
See, I do not know of any study which would any study about that. This question, I don't know.
Okay. There is one more interesting question from Sunita Singh. She is saying that are there any effect of Agnihotra in the breeding pattern of snails?
See, that question assumes that the effect of acne hot or ash is mainly due to some chemical activity. But I'm sure that is only a small part. And it's always If you compare Agnihotra ash with control ash, chemically, we have done the analysis. There was no significant difference. But the effect of Agnihotra ash and control ash is different. Yeah. So activated char, yes, that may be some way to explain some of the effects. But I'm sure that is not the main explanation of the effect.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. And Arvinda Ghosh wants to know something about the Agnihotra ash. He said that the ash that is produced after Agnihotra might be due to activated char with trapped metals, ions, big molecules. Is there any report on the contents of ash, whether it is mixed with some other elements?
I think I just answered that question.
Okay. Not finding any more questions. Okay. There is one more question from Dr. Lata. He wants to know, is there any effect of Agnihotra in our neural conduction?
In our what? I don't see the question. I see, still see the
yes,
question.
Yes, sir.
Gosh.
He is asking about, is there any effect of Agnihotra in our neural nervous system conduction?
Yes, there is. There were several studies which show the effect of Agnihotra on our nervous system. And one study showed that the percentage of alpha waves is a lot increased if you perform Agnihotra, and beta waves, which are more standing for activity and also stress, they're much reduced. So there is some big effect of Agnihotra on our whole system.
One question from Ojashvi Singh. She wants to know that what elements are exactly present in the Agnihotra ash? What negative ions will Agnihotra leave in the atmosphere?
These are two questions. One is, you know, the elements of Agnihotra ash are just those elements which you expect when you burn organic matter. So of course it's some carbon, it is some metals, but you can't say exactly, because every cow dung is different, ghee also may be different to some extent, so every analysis gives some little bit of results. But again, there's not a big difference between Agnihotra ash and control ash. So the analysis of the elements present in Agnihotra ash will not be sufficient to explain the effects of Agnihotra ash, because then control ash would have to have the same results. And then negative ions, I don't properly understand the question, what negative ions will Agnihotra leave? There will be an increase in negative ions. You know, always in the atmosphere, there are some positive ions and some negative ions. And there should be a little bit more negative ions than positive ions, because that helps to purify the atmosphere. And Agnihotra just increases the amount of negative ions.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now ending the query session. Rest of the questions will be answered through mail. And it's time to thanks our key speaker, Dr. Ulrich Berg, for making us conscious toward our environment and health by performing Agnihotra, which is a very simple process and can be performed anywhere. I would also thanks our HOD, Dr. Shekhar Jain, providing me the opportunity, as well as the staff members of Faculty of Life Sciences for their unconditional support. At last, but not the least, I would express my hearty thanks to all the participants of this international webinar. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, one last thing. Can you please, in this comment or chat space, add my email address so that people who have more questions or want to have more information, they could send me an email if they did not write it down before.
Oh, sir, I will forward you. They have my email address. I will forward you.
Okay, that's fine.
And for all the participants, a feedback link has been posted in the chat box and it will be open for half to 1 hour. Please fill it for getting your e-certificates. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ulrich sir. Thank you, Shekhar sir.
Thank you, everybody. And see you. Hopefully, see you sometime also in person in Mansour.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Most welcome.
Okay.